The reading tonight is Jonah chapter 3. Jonah chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. This is the proclamation he issued in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let people or animals, herds or flocks, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink, but let people and animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened.
Let's pray again as we come to God's word. Father God, thank you that your word is here for us to understand. Thank you for your living word, Jesus Christ, and for his spirit. Please would you be at work in us, Lord, as we listen to your word tonight through your spirit, so that you apply it to our hearts, so that you change us for your good, so that you are at work to build us into your people and to work for your glory. Would you speak, O Lord, this evening for your glory? Amen. Henry Jerek. I don't know whether you know that name at all, whether you've heard it before, but Henry Jerek was a guy who in 1946, he was a Lutheran pastor. He was from Missouri, and he found himself called to pastor to the Nazi leadership who were on trial for their lives at Nuremberg. So these were the people who had survived the war and were being essentially held to account for their war crimes. And they had obviously committed terrible atrocities. They were on trial for appalling crimes. And Jerek had his doubts. Jerek was not keen on being sent to do this piece of work. Both of his sons had been injured in the war with the Nazis. But he went. And for over a year during that time, he held out the gospel to these men. And over the course of that year, if truth be told, most of them completely rejected what he had to say. Goebbels was one of them, and Goebbels didn't take a step back. Goebbels did, about 3 weeks before his execution, very cynically suggest that he wouldn't mind taking the Lord's Supper if that was okay, because just in case it turned out to be true, it would be useful. And Jerek was having none of that. He wouldn't do it. But others did respond. Ribbentrop, who had been Hitler's foreign minister, said these last words on the scaffold as he climbed up to be hanged. I place all my confidence in the Lamb who made atonement for my sin. May God have mercy on my soul. And then, and this is the bit that gets to me in this story, then he turned round to Jerek and he said, I'll see you again. So I don't know how you react to that story. You may rejoice in the power of Christ's redemptive love, even in the midst of a profound evil. You may feel angry that a life of cruelty and hatred could have been turned around in that way, right at the death. But it is undeniably a powerful story. We've got right and we've got wrong. We've got hatred and we've got love. There is justice for evil, but there is mercy for those who repent. God sent a messenger to those men in Henry Jerek. And some rejected the message, but others heard it and responded to it. And Jonah 3 gives us a very similar situation. Because Jonah is sent to preach to the Ninevites. Now, Nineveh at the time was the largest city in the world. It was the capital of the Assyrian Empire. And as such, it was at the heart of a cruel and a murderous regime. It remains a byword today for appalling war crimes, unimaginable violence and cruelty. The Ninevites took great pleasure in and great pride in the vicious destruction of other nations and of the torture and killing of the people that lived in them. They reveled not just in killing them, but in torture. And we know about that because they recorded it for themselves for posterity. They were so proud of it, they carved it into stone. You can go and see it at the British Museum. And Jonah was sent into their city to preach God's word to them. So as we come to this passage tonight, we're going to consider, first of all, the message that Jonah took them. And then we're going to think about how they responded to that message. And then we're going to think about ourselves. So as we look at Jonah chapter 3, we see straight away that God is in control of everything that is happening. He sends Jonah to the great city of Nineveh a second time. Because obviously this is Jonah 3, and he already sent him to the great city of Nineveh the first time, and Jonah refused to go. And we've seen the consequences of what happened. Jonah, amongst other things, has learned that disobeying God has significant consequences. So now he's back, and God sends him again to Nineveh. And he gives him very, very specific instructions. He says, go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message that I give you. So Jonah is really a mouthpiece here. Jonah is not going to Nineveh off his own back. Goodness only knows he didn't want to go at all. And he's not going there to kind of see how the land lies and decide what he's going to say. He's going there to deliver God's message. And that message is stark. Verse 4. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. That's it. That is everything Jonah has to say in Jonah chapter 3. 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. And on the surface, I think that looks pretty uncompromising and it looks pretty unpromising. You've got one guy, a foreign guy, in a city that is, you know, not notorious for its kindness to foreigners. On his own, it's a huge city. He's a day's journey into a city that needs 3 days to get across it. He offers no mitigation at all. He just brings this threat. And he's got all of Nineveh in front of him. 40 more days, and all this is coming to an end. God's message to the Ninevites is essentially judgment. They are living lives of ungodliness in the center of a reign of terror, and God is saying, I will not stand for that. Whatever else we see about God in this chapter, and we will see a lot about God in this chapter, we must see that God is a God of justice. God is a God who cares about oppression. God is a God who cares about disobedience and injustice and who punishes it. He will deal with the wrong of Nineveh and with the wrong of the world. And it's important that we see that at the outset. God's primary message to the Ninevites who are disregarding him is, I will judge you for what you are doing. But it isn't only that. Because as well as the message that Jonah brings, we also need to consider who the messenger is. Because as I said before, this is Jonah chapter 3. And Jonah is very much a book of two halves. Because there are two sendings. Jonah 1, God sent Jonah to Nineveh. He refused to go and tried to run away. That did not go well. He ended up being thrown off a boat into the sea, essentially to drown as a judgment for his refusal to obey God. But God rescued him. Jonah chapter 2 is a song of praise and a song of repentance from Jonah to the Lord for saving him using the fish. And then Jonah is sent again to Nineveh, and as we see in this passage, he goes and he preaches. And Jonah 4 is then Jonah's interaction with God after that, which we'll see next time. So, of course, the consequences of his refusal to obey have been very significant for Jonah. God judged him. He was thrown to his death from a boat. He was miraculously rescued by a fish. That's probably what he's most famous for. He repented and he praised God for his salvation. He came to obedience, and here we are. And I think we can assume that the story of this guy being rescued by a giant fish has reached the Ninevites. So Jonah himself, as a messenger, is a sign. He's a sign of judgment. He's a sign that disobeying God has consequences. But he's also a sign of God's mercy. Because although he was disobedient, he was rescued. He's a sign that repentance is possible. He's a sign that God can save. In all, Jonah is a sign that God has authority, that God can judge, that God has the power to act, that God has the intention to act, and that he follows through on what he says he's going to do. So the Ninevites hear this message of impending judgment, and they hear it from someone who is a living sign of that judgment, but also, crucially, a living sign of God's mercy. Now, people, generally speaking, do not like to be judged, I think it's fair to say. They really do not like to be told that what they're doing, the way they're living, is wrong. Our society has a very deep-seated belief that people should be able to live however they like, and that there should be no consequence or judgment for that. I think if you had to come up with a watchword for the Western world in 2022, it would be, you do you. You just live how you want to live, and it's nobody's business but your own. The idea that one person might think somebody else's life immoral or wrong, or that there's a God who judges, is profoundly offensive to people. But I think we would be mistaken if we thought that that was just a modern idea. I do not think that the Ninevites were kind of sitting there open to some constructive criticism of their lifestyle. The Ninevites were fierce and proud and victorious and cruel, and the Ninevites were delighted with their lifestyle. They were not open to the idea that they were in the wrong. So Jonah's just undiluted message of God's judgment does not seem on the surface like a promising tactic to change their minds. But miraculously, they believe it. Verse 5. The Ninevites believed God. Plain and simple, and they matched that belief with action. It wasn't just lip service. Look at what they do in verse 5 and 6. A fast was proclaimed. They clothed themselves in sackcloth and they clothed themselves in ashes. And these are profound responses to the news of God's judgment. They both symbolize mourning. They both indicate a sort of denial of self, a setting aside of their pleasurable lifestyle, a kind of setting aside of their personal dignity. Fasting in sackcloth and ashes is an act of self-abasement. And in the Old Testament, it is spiritually significant. Fasting and prayer, it's about seeking God. So what we can certainly be clear on straight away from verse 5 is that these inhabitants of a rich and a dominant society have a total turnaround in their attitude when they hear what Jonah says. They acknowledge the rightness of God's judgment on them. And they acknowledge his authority to deliver that judgment and his authority to punish them. In fact, God's authority and power is totally unquestioned in this entire chapter. And this goes all the way to the top. The king of Nineveh, probably the most powerful person in the world at that time, rises from his throne, which is symbolic. He steps away from the symbol of his power. He acknowledges his own lack of authority and he makes a decree. And actually, even the decree, I think, is not particularly authoritative, because what he does is confirm what people are already doing. He says, we're going to have a fast. And he makes it the most extreme fast it's possible to imagine. Even the animals have to fast. He commands that everyone dress in sackcloth. And he makes explicit why. He says, let everyone call urgently on God. And what's more, he acknowledges the reason that God has promised to overthrow the city. He says that their people should give up their evil ways and violence. So this response that we see is all-encompassing, really. The Ninevites fast. They call on God. They renounce their evil and their violence. They acknowledge their evil and their violence. They repent. They repent in sackcloth and ashes. In fact, they act as though they were the covenant people of God. They acknowledge his authority and they throw themselves on his mercy. And that is an amazing thing. It's remarkable because they are, in fact, not the covenant people of God. They are outsiders. They are foreigners. They are, in fact, enemies of God's people. But it's also remarkable because they have absolutely no assurance whatsoever that this repenting will have any effect. We've already considered that Jonah's message is deeply uncompromising because he just does not give them a crumb of comfort. He just announces their impending destruction. He does not promise any kind of alternative if they change their behavior. He actually doesn't even mention that as a possibility. He certainly doesn't invite them to repent. He just says, 40 more days and this is done, you're over, it's out. And if you look at verse 9, even the king doesn't seem to hold out much hope that this is going to work. Who knows? That's what the king says, who knows? God may yet relent. It is just doing it on the off chance in one sense. All he knows is that this message of judgment is true and it's right. And all he can do is throw himself on the mercy of God and hope that it is available. And in the Old Testament context, this is all the more surprising because the actual covenant people of God, Israel, they had the word of God, they knew the law, they had his promises, they had an understanding of how to seek him and what repentance looked like. They knew what sin was. They knew how to atone for it. They had a history of extraordinary examples of God's intervention on their behalf. But they, despite numerous prophets being sent to them, did not throw themselves on God's mercy. In fact, the Assyrians are one of God's means of punishment on Israel. Israel consistently turned away. The Ninevites are given one chance, one. And honestly, it's pretty thin gruel. A certain promise of God's righteous anger and no particular hint of an alternative, except possibly the backstory of the prophet they've been sent. But they take their chance. They acknowledge their sin and they repent. They deeply mourn their evil. They do a complete 180. And verse 10 shows us something else truly remarkable. Because although the king's proclamation really sounds like a last desperate throw of the dice, he doesn't sound very confident. Who knows? God, in fact, does see what they're doing and does have compassion on them. And their destruction is averted. And in response to their turning, God turns. He does turn from his fierce anger so that they will not perish. Verse 10 says, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction that he had threatened. And so we see another aspect of God. God is a God of authority and of justice and of power. But God is also a God of mercy and a God of compassion. So before we go any further, it is worth quickly addressing the question of what exactly happened to the Ninevites. Are they saved? Or is their destruction just delayed? Or what? Well, I can't tell you for certain, I'm afraid, because the matter of who is saved and who isn't is miles above my pay grade. And this is one of those topics where the commentators have a lot to say and disagree with one another, and I think we can conclude that they don't know either. So for me, I'm inclined to say that they probably were brought into the kingdom, that they were saved. And that is just my opinion, and I can't prove it, and if you disagree with me, then that's fair enough. But I'm very drawn to the way that Jesus talks about the Ninevites. I said earlier on that the Ninevites were given the sign of Jonah, and you might have spotted at the time, if you know your New Testament, that that is not actually my phrase. That is a phrase originally said by Jesus. And if you turn with me briefly to Luke 11, we'll have a look what he has to say about the Ninevites. We'll read from verse 29, and in a minute I'll give you a page. Page 1043, put something in Jonah. So I'll start reading at verse 29. As the crowds increased, Jesus said, "This is a wicked generation. It asks for a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was assigned to the Ninevites, so also will the Son of Man be to this generation." And then if we jump to verse 32, "The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now something greater than Jonah is here." Something greater than Jonah is here. The people of Nineveh repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now one greater than Jonah is here. In Jonah's teaching, the Ninevites saw a God of justice and a God who was angry at their violence and their evil, and they acknowledged their culpability and they repented. And Jesus is one who is greater than Jonah, because Jesus is the God of justice. He talks in the very verses we've just read of the judgment that is coming when all people, Ninevites, Israelites, St. Albanites, will stand up and will face the consequences for their actions. It is Jesus who is coming again to be that judge. And yet Jesus is saying here, the generation to whom he was sent 2,000 years ago in the Near East, the Israelites of the time, who had all the teachings of the prophets, who knew all of God's law, who were his covenant people, who had every advantage the Ninevites didn't have, who had Jesus standing amongst them in person, they did not repent. They asked for a sign to prove what they were seeing. And the Ninevites, who were indisputably awful, are held out as an example to the Israel of Jesus' day because their reaction to God was the right one. They repented and they turned and they wore sackcloth and ashes and fasted and mourned their sin. And they realized that God's mercy was all they could possibly hope for, and they threw themselves on it. And in Jesus, we have a certain hope that if we call on God's mercy, we will be saved. Greg quoted Romans 8 this morning. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Later on in Romans 10, we read that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Because Jesus has paid the price for the sin of all those who trust him. In his death, justice is done. The God of justice is satisfied. And because justice is done, mercy is freely available in Christ. If you want to know the just and merciful God who sent his messenger to the Ninevites, he's speaking for himself in Luke 11. And so Jesus' generation will be condemned by the Ninevites at the final judgment because they had the best sign of all and they took no notice of it. They were unrepentant. And you probably don't have to be a rocket scientist to see where this is going when we think about ourselves. How will we respond to the word and the authority of God? What do we think of our own sin? Because today, the message and the person of Jesus is still ignored by many, by a huge majority in this country. But they too will stand up at the judgment. But it's not too late. Where the king of Nineveh just hoped that God would relent and turn away his anger, we can have absolute confidence that he will in Christ. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, but we must repent. We cannot hear this word and persist in unrepentant sin. So if you're here this evening or you're watching on the video and you do not trust Jesus, then the warning to the Ninevites is a warning to you. God is just and he will not tolerate wickedness. And one greater than Jonah is here. Trust Jesus and know the mercy that is found in him. Repent of your sin and turn to Jesus for mercy. Jonah is just not a children's story about a fish. It is a real warning. But perhaps that's not actually your take on this chapter. Perhaps as you read this chapter and you listen to what I'm saying, whether you're a Christian or not, you might be thinking something quite different. As we think about how this applies to us, you might be thinking, yeah, all right, the Ninevites were awful. And they were. But you know, I'm not in the same league as those guys. The Ninevites were at the heart of one of the most brutal regimes in history. I'm not. Your opening example was the Nazi leadership. Those people were uniquely appalling. I'm not. And of course, you know, in one sense that is true. I trust that nobody here is guilty of genocide. But there is enormous danger in comparing our sin with the sin of other people and feeling okay about it. Because it betrays in us that we don't really feel the weight of our sin. We don't feel its seriousness. And so whether we intend to or not, we start to feel that maybe we've been saved because, you know, the Ninevites, they needed God's mercy, but I kind of deserved it. And not really, at its heart, that is just unrepentance. You know, I'm pretty nice. I pay my taxes. I haven't committed any major crimes. I love my children. I give to charity. Why wouldn't God want me? That thinking is just a disaster. Red alert. That kind of self-reliance leads to God's condemnation. Self-reliance really is just unrepentance in smart clothes. We need to understand that all sin is serious. All of us have rejected God in one way or another. All of us disobey. Not everything we do is always awful. If we're living for Christ, we'll do much that pleases him. But all of us can be half-hearted and hard-hearted. All of us rebel against God. Phil prayed this morning. I thought very helpfully with just a list of ways that we fall again and again. The extent to which we're prepared to argue our sin away is the extent to which we make light of Jesus' death for that sin. This is really serious stuff. If we don't repent of our sin, then we're not heeding the warning. So, what does genuine repentance look like? As we come to the end, five very quick things. Firstly, as we've seen, I think it means being honest about our wrongdoing. It's very easy to brush stuff under the carpet, to pretend to ourselves that things aren't a problem, that other people are worse, to think that if it's private and nobody finds out, that's okay. But of course we know that that isn't right, and that we've got to face the Lord and not everyone else. Being honest with ourselves and with God is vital. The king of Nineveh immediately acknowledged the evil and the violence of his people. We need to acknowledge our sin. That's number one. Secondly, repentance means calling on God. If a private acknowledgement of our wrongdoing is the first step, then taking that to the Lord and acknowledging the offense and crying out for his mercy is the second step. If we've hurt someone else in the process, then calling on their mercy too may also be a good idea. But like the king of Nineveh, throwing ourselves on the mercy of our Lord is our only hope. But gloriously in Jesus, we know that mercy will come, because all who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So secondly, call on the name of the Lord. Thirdly, it will obviously look like a changed life. The king instructed his people to turn away from evil and violence, not just admit it. If someone who's been in prison tells the parole board that they bitterly regret their crime and then are released and on day one commit it again, what does that tell you about that repentance? It tells you that it was false, And if the system's working, it puts them back in prison. We can't truly say we're repenting of sin if we're not striving daily to leave it behind. So repentance will be visible in the way that we live and the way that we act. And that will look different for every one of us, of course. But transformation and ongoing change in our life will be a visible sign of true repentance. Fourthly, we'll mourn our sin, really mourn it. You may well be able to think of things that you've said and done before you came to faith or even after, that still give you that kind of hot flash of shame when you remember them. I know I can. And in one sense, that shame is unnecessary because the sin is wiped away in Christ. We don't need to keep reliving it. But in another sense, that feeling, that is a mourning for sin. That is a mark of real repentance, that regret. Because to really mourn sin means to feel the weight of it, to struggle with the offense that we've caused against God and against others. And when we feel that, it hurts. That is a sign of repentance. The Ninevites, dressed in sackcloth and ashes and fasted and called on God, they really mourned for what they had done. And fifthly, in this life at least, it is ongoing. We're not told what happened to this group of Ninevites after this. I don't know whether they persisted or fell back. But one slip will not invalidate your salvation. Be encouraged. This is a lifetime of work. If you talk to many people who've been Christians for decades, and there are plenty of them here, they will often say that the longer they go on in the Christian life, the more aware of their sin they become. And that's not, I trust, because they're getting worse and sinning more. It's because their consciences are getting more tender and because they're mourning sin they didn't even notice before. Perfection in this life is unattainable. We will fall and slip. But persistent faith and continual repentance is a right response to the mercy that we have in Christ. So there is much for us to learn from the way that the Ninevites repented and responded to God's word. But as we finish, I think it would be good to rejoice in the ways that we're not like the Ninevites. And I don't just mean that we're not committing genocide. Because we have so much more than they have. We have Christ in us, the hope of salvation. We have the absolute assurance that all who repent and believe can have salvation. The king of Assyria called for repentance with pretty underwhelming words. Who knows? Perhaps God will relent. But we have Romans 10:13. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who calls on the name. Who knows? We do. Because the word of God tells us. What an amazing Savior we have in Jesus Christ. What an extraordinary gift of grace it is to know that as we repent of our sin, the price has already been paid on the cross. How extraordinary to read of Jesus talking about the day of judgment and knowing that on that day when we stand up, he will say, "These are my people." Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word and we thank you for Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection and the promise and the assurance of salvation that we have in him. And we acknowledge, Lord, that we fall way short of your intention for us. We sin and we are half-hearted and we are unloving and we slip and we fall into bitterness. And Lord, we repent of that. We pray that you would work in us through your Spirit to make us more like you. And we pray that you would be at work to use us as a gospel witness to the world, Lord, that you would not let them perish in their sin, but you would call them to repentance and to faith in the Lord Jesus for the glory of his name. Amen. We are going to sing I Stand Amazed, just an opportunity to remind one another again of the extraordinary blessing we have in Jesus. And the work that he did for us on the cross to bring us salvation. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Have a seat.